creative minds in the audience and very distinguished people sitting here, my dear brothers and sisters. I'm sorry, I'll have to speak in English because creativity, as you said, it was a language, and the most comfortable language is what you're most creative in, which all of you are familiar with. So I'll speak in English, and as usual, from Advasuki will translate. So my advance thanks to her. So, yes, you are today holding this conference. My greetings. Your conference is always wonderful to be here with you. I've been here earlier to earlier conferences also. But I think in this particular occasion, when you're celebrating freedom of expression, I think this is very, very, very appropriate in today's situation. And I can only begin by recollecting Bertolt Brecht. When fascism was on the rise in Germany, he was asked once, will they be singing in the dark times? We are going through dark times today. And Brecht replied, yes, they will be singing of the dark times. So your job is to do that singing of the dark times so that you will inspire people to come out of this darkness into the light. And that is the challenge we as politicians face, you as creative minds face, and that is where we converge. And since this is a conference of convergence, I think this is the convergence that is required to break out of these dark times and come out to the light of the future, which is what India is all about, the India's unity that we'll have to celebrate. All the history of human civilization, it's a continuing history. And that history is nothing but the battle of ideas. It is the battle of ideas that carried forward human progress, human civilization, and that is what it shall do even today. But always in history, you will find the opposition to this battle, in this battle of ideas, to ideas that threaten the status quo of the existing ruling classes. I mean, this is nothing new. You've seen it from the days of Socrates when he was poisoned 2400 years ago, down to various, I mean, whether Marx, Engels, Lenin, or down in our country to what is happening, what happened, unfortunately, to Dabolkar, Pansare, Kalburgi, and Gauri Lankesh. The ideas have to be killed, and that is when the ruling classes can control their rule. Except, of course, for instances where ideas whip up hatred, whip up animosity, and whip up leading to violent killings. Such ideas, by law, need to be curbed. But not allowing ideas contrary to the ruling class point of view or contrary or challenging the ruling class point of view, that is the history of human civilization. We are going through such a phase today very intensely, and like always, ultimately it is the idea that will triumph, and that is what we all have to struggle to ensure. That's why there is a history in the world against the, in this battle of ideas of attacking, opposing and killing those who hold contrary ideas. In our own country, our own civilization, Hitler burnt books in Germany when the fascism was rising. We did that some centuries earlier, we meaning in India. You burnt the Lokayata, you banned Charvaka, you wouldn't listen to their point of view. This is the centenary of Devi Prasad Chattopadhyay. He reconstructed Lokayata from the attacks of Nagarjuna, philosophical attack. But the original text is not there. So we've gone through all this in our own civilization. But when you have gone through all this, why is it that today this is happening? You're all creative people. You go from the immediate into the background and search for the reasons that bring out the reasons from the depths of thought. You will have to do that exercise with the present challenge today. Why is this growing intolerance today? Why is this happening? Is it suddenly whims and fancies of some individual? Or what are the hidden processes that are leading to this sort of a atmosphere of hatred, intolerance that is growing in the country and claiming innocent lives? Those, the deeper mechanics of why this is manifesting this way, need to be understood properly, and I think you are the best minds to do that and the best minds to creatively express what is actually happening behind the screen of growing intolerance and hatred today. That's why today, what is there in the shadows behind the current manifestation of growing hatred and intolerance? Why this has emerged today, in my opinion, is that there is a continuing battle of visions that is taking place in India for nearly a century. And that is throwing up the situation today. And what is this battle of visions? In the decade of the 1920s, there arose a question that was fiercely debated in India before many of us were born, of what would be the character of independent India. Three visions emerged. One, the dominant vision, saying given our diversity, not only religious but cultural, linguistic, etc., etc., the only way India can be united and can thrive as a republic is on the basis of a secular democratic republic. That was accepted by the left, but they said that is not sufficient. The communist vision said we have to go beyond just the secular democratic republic. The political freedom of our people must be converted into the economic freedom of every individual, and that can happen only through the movement towards socialism. But contrary to both these, emerged the third vision, which had a full expression. And that vision was that India's future will be determined by the religious denomination of its people. There emerged the concept of an Islamic state, the Muslim League championing that, which led to the unfortunate partition of India and the creation of Pakistan and later Bangladesh. And the other expression, twin expression, was the RSS version of a Hindu Rashtra. So the Muslim League, the Islamic State, and the RSS Hindu Rashtra were the twin expressions of the third vision that came. When we won our freedom, the Indian people rejected the RSS vision, while the Islamic State vision was fulfilled or created partly or fully in the creation of Pakistan, but India rejected a theocratic, fascistic Hindu rush, and we opted for a secular democratic republic. And that was the reason, the prime reason, that led to the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi, saying that he prevented this vision from unfolding. And many of us got thought that the same Sardar Patel who banned the RSS after Gandhi's assassination, saying, what did he say? The cult of violence sponsored by the sun has claimed many innocent lives, the latest being Gandhiji himself, unquote, according to memory, but I'm sure it's more or less correct. And that same Sardar Patel being appropriated by them, many of us thought that after that the battle ended. No, the battle has been continuing since. And that battle is to convert our secular democratic republic into the RSS version of a fascistic Hindu rush. If that has to be achieved, assault on reason is the first step that will be undertaken. Because if there is reason, then they cannot win in this battle of visions. And that is why this assault on reason begins, mounts, and it will intensify in the future unless you and I together, all of us together, resist it, fight it, and send it back to the confines of history. I think I should also not speak to say long, long gaps for her. But then that's a problem with talking about reason and rationality. But then why this attack on reason if they want to succeed in the project? Because their vision and the project runs against the actual basic truth of our existence. A Hindu Rashtra in India cannot really gel with the sort of diversity that we have, and not merely a Hindu Rashtra, but with the supremacy of the language, the culture, and the entire process of what they represent of the North Indian Hindus. That is not India. It runs against our own reality. If their vision has to succeed, you have to create a history. If you have to create a history, reason and rationality cannot be the basis. And that is why today, what is happening in higher education is the replacement of the study of Indian history by the study of Hindu mythology. Anything that we do today or said today goes back to the Ramayana or the Mahabharata. Every single episode goes there. Now reason makes you question, like I used to question my grandfather when I was young, and he used to tell me the story of Ramayana chapter by chapter every night. I used to ask him the question, I said, why is it that every king south of the Vedas in the Ramayana is depicted as an animal? Vali, Sugriva, Jambavanta, Hanuman. We are not human beings, yeah? South of India. Yeah? Then my grandfather again was very angry with me. He said, why are you asking absurd questions, you are listening, etc., etc. He used to scold me. But that is the reason. You want a reasonable answer. Why is this happening? I've not got with any veracity. We unfortunately don't have time to do much research. But it's obvious that that epic story was being written at a time when the Aryan and Dravidian, this tussle was going on who will dominate whom. The Aryan supremacy that was achieved at that time was reflected in the biggest bhakta of Rama being Hanuman, the Dravidian. Hanuman is the Dravidian prince. So the Dravidian paying obeisance to the Aryan, that is the social history of the epic. But that reason and reality has to be hidden if you have to say that these are gods and these gods came down and we are all living according to them, and therefore the Ram Mandir, the temple, now Ayodhya, again the entire tensions have begun, and that will happen. Or what is happening with Sabarimala? I'll come to that, otherwise it will get too long again. That is why today the attack and assault on reason is imperative for the third vision to succeed if you want to create India into a Hindu Rashtra. So it is not something that is abnormal. It is not happening because of the fringe. It is happening because it is intrinsic to the concept of a Hindu Rashtra that you have to assault reason and rational thinking. Without that, they cannot succeed. And that is why these attacks on higher education, JNU, Hyderabad Central University, art school in the Baroda, one of the premier art colleges and institutions in our country, or whether it's the Film Institute. I mean, all these have to be attacked because no amount of creative thinking and reason should appear on the horizon, otherwise that is the biggest obstacle for them. That is why the object is what? If the Hindu Rashtra project has to succeed, replace the teaching of India's rich syncretic history with the study of Hindu mythology. Replace the traditions of India's rich traditions of philosophy by Hindu theology. So history, Hindu mythology, philosophy, Hindu theology. Unless we do this, unless they succeed in this, they cannot succeed in that Hindu rush. So assault on reason is inherent in that very philosophy of this Hindu Rashtra. It is not happening because some fringe group somewhere is attacking. There is nothing called the fringe in the RSS. The fringe is the core of the RSS, and that is what is happening. That is why this assault on reason. Once again, I was talking about Sabarimala today. What is happening there? When the petition in the High Court to allow women to enter the temple in Sabarimala was moved by people sympathetic to the RSS. On that, the judgment comes permitting. I'm saying there is equality prescribed in the Constitution, the fundamental. The Constitution says equality, social and economic, quote, irrespective of caste, creed or sex, unquote. So it's fundamental. BJP welcomes when the judgment comes. And now they are protesting there at Sabarimala. Now the same BJP, same RSS, when it came down to the triple talaq issue, they refused to allow the parliament to actually go through the legislation thoroughly through a select committee. In the Rajya Sabha, Select Committee proposal is pending. But they were in a hurry and went and brought out an ordinance. And in that ordinance, the argument they gave is equality for women. That is, that sanctity must be maintained. On triple talaq, you want equality for women. But on Sabarimala, you don't want the equality for women. Why does that speak? Because it suits them to whip up that passion on the basis of which they sing and thereby attack reason and rationality. These sort of arguments that I am putting are not heard. I mean, you have lumpens there ruling the roofs of the roads there. And these, there is no reason, no rationality, but whipping up of these passions to serve their purpose. That is the reality today. That's why my party has always opposed the arbitrary and the instant application of triple talaq. We said, yes, we have to change all that. But we were, you know, inspecting that in the parliamentary committee, but no ordinance is brought in. Now, in the Sabarimala issue, everybody knows, in the Supreme Court verdict, the only way you can circumvent that verdict is through the parliament, passing through a legislation or a new law or an ordinance. For Sabarimala, you will bring an ordinance, but on this you won't. Because you won't make it. That's not your objective. Your objective is rouse passion, create tension. There are 6 review applications of the Supreme Court order now pending before the Supreme Court. Then you wait for the Supreme Court's review, what is their answer? No? We'll foment this trouble because that way that helps me in dividing the society, helps me consolidate my Hindutva communal vote bank. The worst vote bank politics that's being played in the country. And for this to be played, you require to replace Indian nationalism with Hindutva nationalism. You will say Bharat Mata Ki Jai, that is patriotic according to them, not Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose's Jai Hind, not Bhagat Singh's Inqilab Zindabad. They are not patriotic. Only Bharat Mata Ki Jai is patriotic. That is Hindutva nationalism versus Indian nationalism. Now this is the battle where unfortunately, I see the prominent media persons here, unfortunately large sections of media are also aiding and abetting them. We are living in what is called a post-truth society. Post-truth is a situation, Oxford Dictionary defines, word of the year 2016, where the ground realities are set aside, where on the basis of emotions and a personality cult, people are led to believe on the actual reality. And that is what is happening in Modi's India. You find a very happily contented, smiling Prime Minister of India in a big advertisement on every petrol pump, when every car or scooter driver goes there in agony to fill up petrol. But the Prime Minister is happy, a big, big advertisement. And that is, you know, that is the disconnect of the real India and what they are actually showing. And our media, my only appeal to them, is don't say, carry news saying, Amit Shah says it's raining, Yechury says it's not raining. Please open the window and see if it's raining or not raining. please report the truth, and that is what India needs today in this battle. In this battle of ideas and visions that I'm talking about. In this battle against this post-truth, the situation that we have. Before I end, I'd like to only recollect a seminal work that was done by internationally renowned, you call him a critique, an art critic, a cultural policy person, a great Marxist theoretician, George Lucas. George Lucas wrote a seminal book called The Destruction of Reason. And this is a book that he began writing when Hitler was in power, but it could finally publish in Hungary after Second World War. But what was this book examining? It was started from a simple question, saying that the German people, the inheritors of the legacy of the most rational, scientific, philosophical traditions the world has produced till then, the philosophy of Hegel, the philosophy of dialectics, the philosophy of rationality, How did this German people, steeped in that philosophical tradition, accept the philosophy of fascism and Hitler? What happened to these people? Why did they not resist this thing philosophically with such rich tradition? And what is the conclusion he comes to? The rise of fascism was accompanied by a systematic attack on rationality. Rational philosophy was replaced systematically by irrational philosophy, what in philosophical terms is called irrationalism. So irrationalism growing removed the faculty of reasoning amongst the people, that they finally came to accept Hitler and fascism as a given need for that day. This has very important pointers for us in India. You create a situation where they say Hindutva is needed for the progress of India. For the last 7 decades, nothing happened in India except that that Mr. Modi is doing all that for India that's possible. So for India, you require this philosophy. That is the whole the argument and the atmosphere that is being built up. So assault on reason is absolutely imperative for the rise of such philosophies and for them to win in this battle of ideas and visions. You are all creative people. It is you who have to create that consciousness and that reasoning back into the minds of the people. And remember, as far as I was saying, you are all creative people. India expects, finally, my appeal to all of you, India expects you to rise to the occasion to create the consciousness among the people based on reason and rationality against the madness that is happening today. Unless we do that, we cannot save our country. And unless we save our country, we cannot change it for the better. And please remember, all the major artists in the world have all had an ideological persuasion through which they work. I've often quoted Picasso to you in the past. The same Picasso, you go today to Madrid, see in that Reina Sofia, a special exhibition that is kept for his Guernica. When Guernica was painted, Picasso makes the break from cubism, open windows, etc., to the open world. And when the Spanish police, Franco, dictator Franco's police came to raid his studio, they asked Picasso, "You did this," pointing towards the painting of Guernica. Picasso answered, said, "No, you did it, the police. Guernica was a village that was destroyed by the fascist forces. It is the pathos of that village that's captured in that masterpiece." Now, you may call it the rebel, you may call it the rational, you may call it the reasonable person. The conscience of the artist is by far more powerful. Like they always say, the pen is mightier than the sword, is more powerful in the realm of ideas. You'll have to generate those ideas in today, for the sake of ourselves, for the sake of our immediate families, for the sake of our country, and for the sake of our future, so that we can all build a better India. That is my final appeal. Celebrating freedom of expression means joining the struggle to safeguard reason and rationality.